Welcome, everybody. Facebook Live at 5. It's Monday. Yep. Wait. No, that one. Yep. American flags hanging, right? Like what Jim Craig had when he won. I know what you're thinking. You want to dive into that 1980 U.S. Olympic team. All right. Shout outs. How about my family? Are we here? My St. Mark people, Lion Pride's in the house, I hope. VBC, always need you, and my AAU people. Let's do this. Oh, in honor of Wayne Coffey, it looks like our numbers are up. So our number one state remains California, but the top five, New York is in. Solid, because we know we're going to go to Sleepy Hollow to say hello to Wayne Coffey. Florida is in. That's the headquarters of AAU. Massachusetts is in. Boston U, right? Minnesota comes strong this week because there's awful lot coming from Minnesota that have to do with this story. And then always holding on to that number two spot,
Ohio.
They just, those Ohio people, they just, they don't give up. They don't give up, those people. They keep coming. Hey, I got an idea. Let's start the show. I'm a Venice, California-born, Los Angeles-based sports fan. One that has played, coached, announced, and promoted sports my whole life. My love affair with sports started in my own backyard and has led me to this podcast. Thanks to the support of the Amateur Athletic Union in East Bay, I'm excited to bring you Sports Stories with Denny Lennon. Coming to you live from Los Angeles, it's the top-rated show in the Sentinella Adobe Corridor. Operating in the shadow of LAX, out of the 7428 studio, where Jimbo is at the controls and Buck takes a nap until he's got to take a crap. It's Facebook Live at 5.
Hi, everybody. Christine here. I'm here to tell you where to find us on social media. So if you can remember these three phrases, you can find us anywhere. The first, Sports Stories Podcast. The second, Sports Stories with Denny Lennon. That's Denny like the restaurant, Lennon like the Beatle, or Sports Stories DL. We're on Instagram, we're on Twitter, we're on Apple, Spotify, iHeartRadio, YouTube, and of course here on Facebook. Like us, subscribe. If you had a podcast, we'd like you and we'd subscribe to you.
All right, coming up this week on the show, we have a great week, actually. Today, as you know, Wayne Coffey, author of The Boys of Winter, is here. So that takes care of Monday. How about we look at Tuesday? Tuesday, well, produced by Mike Boley, two-time VBC champion Mike Boley. We return to the Venice Backyard Championship show, about the great and legendary Venice Backyard Championships. That tournament played from 1983 to 1995. Harding Avenue in Venice, 5 backyards, 3 front yards, and we're reliving it each and every week. Mike Boley gets to produce. That's tomorrow night. On Wednesday, we got something that's really unique that I think you'll enjoy. Remember, on Wednesdays, it's our high school to Olympians division, and that was a standout high school player, a little guy by the name of Paul George. That's right. We have exclusive footage from Paul George, who had a breakout game in what was called the Battle of the Valley All-Stars. And it was a postseason All-Star game. And he was playing, if I'm not mistaken, at Palmdale High School at the time. And he breaks through, has a huge game. It's really cemented his leap to Fresno State. And then we all know how, you know, how he just tore it up from there moving forward. So really going to be a cool game. Now, also have Eric Sonheimer and Randy Rosenblum, the original broadcast team from that game. They'll come back and relive it. So tune in on Wednesday. That should be really something. Thursday, we drop our video podcast. That's Wayne Boley taking the 74-28 shot. Wayne Boley, a all-conference basketball player and an All-American volleyball player in the 1960s, when at then what was then called Loyola University. He led an extraordinary life from that moment to now, where he's a recently retired or semi-retired attorney. Now, what makes it interesting and important is that Wayne protected Loyola Marymount in the case, in the Hank Gathers case. And that whole story about Hank Gathers will play out throughout these episodes. And we went to the memorial of the dedication of the statue. And then 2 days later, on March 2nd, we sat down in the studio with Wayne Boley. So that drops on Thursday, part one of three. I think it's going to be a really good series, and you'll be fascinated to hear from Wayne. And then finally, Friday, the happy hour show of record. That, if you don't recognize him, is St. John Smith. And St. John will be joined by his predecessor, what you may also call a king of the beach, Jim Mingus. That's right. So Mingus, St. John Smith, Wayne Boley will drop by as well, are going to headline our Friday show, which should really be interesting, because when you think of how beach volleyball grew up on the shores of Southern California and then is now the most attractive component to the Summer Olympic Games, it gets the highest ratings, it owns the primetime spot. What a trip that sport has taken. And two of the original architects of that sport will be on the Friday show. So good stuff this week. Remember, just tune in at 5 every night. And Thursdays is the night we take off because our video podcast is out. Okay. I'm going to introduce today's guests. Wayne Coffey was on the show Friday night for a short stint, but we get to dive in a little bit deeper. Recently released his book, because it was recently released, because 40 years since the Boys of Winter, that miracle team, captured the gold medal. 1980 at Lake Placid. Many of us know the story. It's been called the greatest sports moment of the century. And this book is fantastic. It dives into each of the players, their backgrounds, including the coaches and the whole scene. It's an awful lot of fun. And we'll get a chance to talk to our guest. Let's bring him in from Sleepy Hollow, New York. Hi, Wayne.
Oh, I muted him. My bad.
Hold on. We're going to... you in? Hey, Wayne.
Denny, I'm here.
My wife did to you what she often does to me, which is mute me.
Sorry, Wayne.
No, you know what? That's okay. In fact, the show might make more sense if I'm muted. But
right. Right. Well, Wayne, I couldn't find my hockey jersey, but I came as patriotic as I could and hung the flag today, as you notice, and then came with, you know, AAU has a great history in the Olympic Games. And then, of course, got to support my Dodgers on Independence Day cap. So came as strong as I could, Wayne.
Well, you know, if you wanted to channel your inner Jim Craig, you could wrap yourself in the flag. Right. And right. And then look for your dad in the stands.
So. Right. Yeah. Well, I figured I'd just let it hang up there and not put it in distress, but put it with the stars up.
By the way, I want you to know, Denny, tonight we're not only your audience is not only in the Sentinella Adobe corridor. There is a visitor who I happen to know is watching from Saranac Lake, New York, which is in the shadow of Lake Placid, where it was snowing today.
Wow.
So there you go. You've got your people are on the case in Saranac Lake and Lake Placid.
Who's watching from Saranac Lake?
It's a gentleman named Sandy Caligiuri, who's an old friend of mine, an Olympic press official from way back. He handles all the press for USA Luge. So if you ever want Erin Hamlin, the most decorated female luger ever, or any other lugers, or if you just want to go, you know, like 110 miles an hour on an open sled down a chute, Sandy is your guy.
Oh, I love it. Okay, good. I like growing the audience. That's why New York got into the top rankings of my states that are watching now. You know, I wanted to show you a couple other things just to establish my hockey credentials, if you don't mind. First, please. I attended Luke Robitaille's retirement dinner, and when he was playing for the Kings, and he may have been the greatest left winger of all time, Luke. That was a lot of fun. And look at this, the coup de grace. I went to game one of the 2007 Stanley Cup when those Ducks found a way to capture the cup. Not bad, huh?
How about that? It's very impressive.
It's not 12 Olympics like you've been to, but, you know, it's something in the hockey world. So, Wayne, I wanted to dive in a little bit before we got into the book. I kind of want to cover some of your other books, but before that, I want to find out a little bit about you. Now, are you a born and raised New Yorker?
More or less. I grew up in Huntington, Long Island, which had a lot more open land and a lot more potato farms then than it does now. But you know, more or less in the New York metro area, Sleepy Hollow is about 30 miles north of the city, right along the Hudson. And it's, as I think I mentioned the other night, it's the Halloween headquarters of the world. So if anyone ever wants to have a good time around Halloween and see a lot of pumpkin patches and haunted hayrides, this is your spot.
What was your elementary school?
It was Manor Plains School in Greenlawn, New York. And, you know, they have yet to erect a statue for me, but I you know, I hope it's coming.
That's right.
But I really have no reason to hope for that. So, but listen, I've been immortalized. I'm on Denny Lennon. So, you know.
Yeah. Well,
you can't ask for more than that. No, I made it.
You can't. Now, legend has it that you were quite fleet of foot as a youngster. You were planning on filling in for Mickey Mantle once he retired. And apparently, from what I've read, a 4:05:40 you were clocked at? Wow.
I was clocked. You have sources, apparently.
Oh, yeah.
You do a lot of prep for your show, Denny. I'm impressed.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
I had some wheels in my prime, which was a number of decades ago, but I'm still upright, and I always loved to run. I was never a marathon runner, but if I needed to go from home to first, I could get there pretty quickly.
Was baseball your main sport, or did you play whatever sport was coming down the pipe in each season?
You know, I'm old enough that, you know, when I grew up, really my baseball glove was on my handlebars pretty much for half the year. And I just go wherever I could to find a baseball game. But I also loved basketball. And I played some kind of a bad version of American soccer in the 70s. But now I'm the proud father of a Penn State All-American player who plays quite a different game than her father ever did. So
she must have picked up those athletic skills from her mother.
I think it was entirely the mother. Also the the intelligence. Though I did get a Penn State vest out of the deal here. You
not
see
bad,
that little
bad. The Nittany yeah. Lion.
Yeah, that's I mean, nice. Before the show's over, I may even say we are.
Oh, gotcha. I understand. You know, I love the regionality of collegiate athletics. It's so much fun. I love dipping in and out of all of those places. When you're young and you're playing your sports, was there somebody that was either a mentor or somebody identified you, said, hey, you know, you're pretty good, or anything along these lines, help point you in the right direction? I always like those people getting a little recognition.
Well, as it happens, I have a brother, Frank Coffey, who might even be tuning in today. And I believe he may have even gotten some great chicken fajitas from a fine eating establishment in Venice, Casablanca. And I hear that those chicken fajitas were to die for. Mm-hmm. And Frank is many, many years older than I am. but he taught me how to shoot jumpers. He taught me how to pitch. He taught me how to hit. And you name it. One of the greatest memories of my life really was to just play catch in the backyard with him. And he bought me back in the day when there were, now I'm really dating myself, but you know, when Converse, Chuck Taylor All-Stars were the only sneakers that you really wore if you were a basketball player. He went to a game in Madison Square Garden where they had a big sports store right in the garden, and he found size 3 Converse sneakers, which I didn't even know they existed. But he left them at the foot of my bed. When I woke up the next day, I saw the telltale red box, and I thought they were his. And he said, "Look at them." And then I looked at the size, and I barely had feet at that point. I mean, they were size 3. They were really little. But he found Chuck Taylor's to fit me and strapped him right on. And, you know, we went out to the driveway and played some balls. So
I love it.
They're great memories. And he's still lighting up the Venice courts when they're open. So you've got to promise me, Denny, you will get this pandemic over with so they open the Venice courts so my brother can get back out there and, like, humble people with his jump shot.
Yeah. You know, you called him a Marina Del Rey guy the other day. You said he lives over in the Marina Del Rey, and I want you to know those are fighting words. You know, somebody from Venice, they go over to Marina Del Rey to launch their boat. They don't, you know, they, from that's like calling a Southie somebody from like Brookline or somebody from Hell's Kitchen is from the village. So I think your brother's a little ticked off about that one.
He might be. You know, I'm an ignorant Eastern boy. I don't really understand these geography wars you have, but I know he's got Venice in his heart. His address might be Marina Del Rey, but I think he's got Venice in his heart.
Well, he's we'll show a little bit later. We got a little clip about him getting I think you at least extending that invitation to him. But in the meantime, I wanted to talk about once you got out of high school, you went to Binghamton University. Is that right?
Binghamton. Yep.
Binghamton. And what was did you always know you wanted to be a writer?
You know, our grandfather was a Presbyterian minister, and the only thing in common with that is that he wrote sermons all the time, and they were wonderful sermons. And he was a wonderful man who was born and raised in Nova Scotia, then went to seminary in the U.S. and was the minister at a church in Woodhaven, Queens, in New York City. And he had a study with a wonderful desk that my brother still has in his place, and it had surrounded by the Harvard classics. So I think without really knowing it, I was kind of immersed in something of a writing culture. And, you know, I did have aspirations to replace Mickey Mantle in center field. In fact, one of my favorite stories ever, this is a side trip here, but I went to Commerce, Oklahoma, the home of Mickey Mantle. And it was surreal to be there, to actually go to the house where Mickey Mantle grew up and to see the corrugated tin shed where he learned to pinch hit. And it was a great thrill. Commerce is not really doing all that well. It's a bit past its prime, but to be in the place where Mickey Mantle grew up was a total hoot. So, but when I realized I probably wasn't going to make it to center field for the Yankees, I studied hard and started writing for the school paper, and sort of one thing led to another. I did it in high school, then I did it in college. I worked for the Associated Press right out of college, and sort of wasn't really sure what I was going to do, but I've been hacking away at keyboards ever since.
You were sent quickly to Cleveland, I think. We were covering the Indians or all of their teams.
That's right. No, all of their teams. Uh-huh. Yeah, actually, and what was interesting about that is it was Frank Robinson's rookie year, when, you know, people will remember that was a huge deal. He broke the color barrier for major league managers. Mm-hmm. And he had a tiny little office in Municipal Stadium. And Frank Robinson, who I later interviewed and, you know, thought the world of as a player and have tremendous respect for. But at the time, his office, his manager's office, was about the size of a closet. And when you went in there with the other members of the press after an Indian defeat, and Frank Robinson would sit there with a scowl on his face, and he would put these big, beefy forearms on the desk in front of you, and, like, you know, dared you to ask him a question about why he went to the bullpen, or why did he make that pinch hitter. So that was my first experience as a professional journalist, basically having to be scraped off of the floor of Frank Robinson's office.
Those are some strong times in Cleveland, because I would imagine were the Browns pumping right then?
Yeah, they were. Brian Sipe was the quarterback, yeah. And they had some good. And the Cleveland Cavaliers were. LeBron was probably not even born, but I'm sure he wasn't. But he, they were. They had Austin Carr and Campy Russell, and Bill Fitch was the coach, who was a wonderful guy and a great raconteur. And I remember when the Knicks, a team that I grew up on. I mean, one of my most vivid memories was rooting for Red Holtzman's Knicks in a 69-70 season. I did the proverbial transistor radio under the pillow and listened to the games, and that was epic for a long-suffering Knicks fan, because they had been pretty much horrendous until he arrived.
You made your way, from Cleveland, and then eventually you started writing books. I don't want to. I don't want to overlook those because they're all such interesting subjects. And I was wondering if you
could. And Danny, one thing that the first book I ever wrote, and I mentioned this, I really don't like to gloat, but it's really a classic in the field. It's called How We Choose a Congress.
Oh.
And it was written for like fifth and sixth graders. And if you spend the next two or three decades, you might be able to find a copy. I remember getting an advance for $3,000, and writing this book, and it probably sold 4.5 copies. But that's when it all started. A book called "How We Choose a Congress."
And you did that when out of college, just out of college?
Just a couple years out of college. And please don't ask me any questions about how we choose a Congress because I don't remember any of it.
You got to let it go.
I let it go.
You got so much room up there. So some of the books that you have here, I just kind of was hoping you'd say something about them. And then, you know, maybe about the principal subject. I think we actually have a video we could play to get everybody a little bit familiar with them. So let's look at that real quick, Wayne. So we'll get back to the Boys of Winter, but tell me a little bit about They Said It Couldn't Be Done, about the story about the 1969 Mets. That's a terrific story that I grew up, I was young, but I'd heard about it by the time I really started getting into baseball, about how terrific that season was.
As a passionate Met fan, and the Mets, of course, had been historically awful. They're the worst team in the history of baseball for their entire existence from 1962 until 1969, when it all magically changed. And I wrote that book last year to come out for the 50th anniversary of, to me, that most miraculous of baseball seasons. And I went around the country and talked to as many of the players as I could find and sort of told their stories about how they got there and what their recollections of the season were. And I was actually at game five of the World Series with my grandfather when the day the Mets clinched, October 16th, 1969, if you're scoring at home. It was about 3:07 p.m., I believe.
Wow, that's so cool. It's so great how sports, you know, just put us in a place. You can just feel it and smell it and everything about it. And you remember who you're with. I love that part of sports. It just strikes that emotional chord. R.A. Dickey, tell me a little bit about that.
So R.A. was a pitcher for the Mets, a knuckleballer who went on to win the Cy Young. It was the year the book came out. So his timing was excellent. one of the most remarkable men and nicest men I've ever met. But his story, and really, if there's a common thread here, Denny, with all of the things that I think that I like to write about that I'm drawn to, is really the improbable champions, the underdogs, if you will, the people who have overcome obstacles. And I think, you know, given what we're all living with right now, you know, it's something to hold on to. And every one of these stories that of these books that I've end up digging into, there's some kind of underdog aspect to it. And with R.A. Dickey, he was a number one draft choice out of the University of Tennessee for the Texas Rangers. And then when he did his supposedly routine pre-draft physical, they found out that he did not have an injured ulnar collateral ligament in his elbow. He did not have an ulnar collateral ligament. And he ended up, they pulled his bonus money, and then he ended up making it to the major leagues, but he was a journeyman and never really went anywhere. And he was about to go play in Korea. But the real powerful part of this narrative is that R.A. was sexually abused as a child, not once but twice, by a male and a female. And until he really came to grips with that and went through therapy and really explored all of this darkness in his past, he was, by his own estimation, a broken man. And he really burned to tell this story with searing honesty. And he really became a hero to people who are survivors of childhood sex abuse. And it was and is a really powerful story about a brave man and an important man who shared his story in the hopes of helping other people.
Yeah, it is. It's really powerful. It's a powerful story. The closer, Mariano Rivera. Any is there any argument that there has been a better closer in the history of the game?
You're not going to get me to argue it. You know, so with Mariano Rivera, what people remember now is that the Hall of Famer, the all-time saves leader, the greatest postseason pitcher ever. But the backstory for Mariano, where he came from, a speck of a town, which is about the most impoverished place I have ever seen, called Puerto Camito, Panama. And he was a fisherman's son. And the morning of his Yankee tryout, he was actually repairing fishing nets. He would go out to sea with his father to fish. And I mean, to get to Panama City from where he was from seemed almost impossible. And to reach the pinnacle of the baseball world with the New York Yankees is unfathomable. And Mariano was so naive. I love this story. So I remember early on we were talking and I said, so when you were a kid, what, you know, who were your baseball heroes? Like, you know, was it Henry Aaron? Was it Babe Ruth? He said, Babe Ruth? I didn't even know who Babe Ruth was. And I said, no, you're kidding. No, I didn't know who Henry Aaron. He had never heard of a single pro baseball player. He didn't own a glove when he went to his Yankee tryout. He did not own a glove. He had two different shoes on, ripped pants. He took two buses for an hour and a half and stopped at a bodega to get a little Panamanian biscuit for breakfast. And then he got on the mound and he threw 10 pitches. And they said, okay, we've seen enough. And then they offered him a whopping bonus. This is really life-changing money, Denny, $2,000. And Mariano was going to accept it, but he thought that he didn't know what it meant. He thought that he would not even have to leave Panama. He could just play baseball in Panama. Mm. They said, no, you have to go to the United States. Mm. You have to go to Tampa. And then if everything goes well, you're going to end up going to New York City. So that was the first time he was ever on a plane.
Jeez.
And he turned into Mariano Rivera. And I mean, when I was in Puerto Camito, I just said, how do you ever get out of this place? And he learned his control. And all the young aspiring pitchers out there may want to remember this. His world famous pinpoint control, he would throw rocks at iguanas in the trees. And wow. So he'd fire a rock at an iguana, pick the iguana right off the tree, and then they had dinner.
Wow. Jesus. Unreal. Carly Lloyd.
So Carly and I worked on the book right after she was the breakout star of the 2015 World Cup. And this was a project of deep personal passion for me because our our daughter Samantha has very much the same aspirations. And Carly too was someone who at age 20 was cut from the US national team and told in no uncertain terms by her coach, "You're not national team material. You're not good enough. Just go home. You're out of shape. You're not a good teammate. You can't do this. You can't do that." At 20 years old. And you know, how did that work out? Two-time World Player of the Year, World Cup icon, still playing now at a very high level. And, you know, would have been a mainstay if there, had there been Tokyo Olympics this year. But, right. I mean, here again, Carly refused. She got, you know, she got knocked on her can in about as tough a way as you possibly can. And as she likes to say, I refuse to let that define me. And that, to me, that's the lesson in the story. All of us get knocked down, and mm-hmm. and you know, and the measure of it is, the cliche is that you, you know, it's how you get back up, you know. Right. It and she really epitomizes that attitude and still does. I mean, Carly still thinks, I told her, you know, you're the only two-time World Player of the Year who has a chip on her shoulder, because you think no one thinks you're any good. And but that motivates her. She finds things to be ticked off about, like, you know, so and so, they think I'm too old, they think I'm this, they think I'm that. So, you know, whatever it takes.
Yeah, we've been watching that on The Last Dance with Michael Jordan.
That's exactly right.
To get a little ticked off about and fired up. Urban Meyer is a guy who could get his troops fired up. And your book was specific to his above the line philosophy, which, you know, every action you take, it's either above the line or below the line type of action or deed or what have you. What was it like, you know, being entrenched with Coach?
Well, I've never met anyone quite like Urban Meyer. And so this was not a football book. This was really a leadership book. It was how to take your team, whether it's young college football players or, you know, a group of lawyers or, you know, people in your manufacturing plant and get them aligned. That's one of his favorite words, is alignment. But so above the line is basically his way of saying that every day, every one of us has a choice, a conscious decision to make. Are we going to be above the line? And, the, you know, are we basically going to settle to be okay? Or are we really going to bring it? Are we going to stretch ourselves? We're going to push. We're going to, you know, demand more and just set the bar as high as it possibly can. I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, but that's the kind of the essence of it. And what I'll always remember about Urban, when I walked into his, so I'm at the Woody Hayes Athletic Complex in Ohio State, and I walk in and I get waiting at the reception area. I'm here to see Coach Meyer. Okay, yeah, he's expecting you. And I walk down this long corridor, and it's full of all the craziest college football memorabilia you've ever seen. You know, Heisman trophies and iconic photos and a who's who of the all time greats. And then right in the middle of it, there is a clock, a ticking clock with days, hours, minutes, seconds going by for the last time Michigan beat Ohio State. And and this is like the most important thing in the whole Woody Hayes Athletic Complex. And this is how obsessed Urban Meyer is about Michigan. When you go Woody Hayes Athletic Complex, think about those letters, complex, C-O-M, letter M right next to N. Two letters before O. When the letters on top of the complex, there is a slash through the M because because that is the evil first letter of the state up north.
That school up
north. No, wait. Now it gets better yet. I'm getting out. I get my notebook out, put the tape recorder on his desk. You know, we start talking about the process of working on the book together. And I start writing some things down. And he says, "Wait a minute. Does that pen have blue ink?" And I thought he was kidding. Oh. And I said, yeah, it does have blue ink. And he said, "Get rid of that. Oh. We don't have blue ink in this office."
Oh my goodness. Wow.
So black was acceptable, red was preferred.
But I could see it. I told you I saw him speak once, and I couldn't believe that guy was so impressive. I can see that. What an interesting book. The last one I want to talk to you about is Winning Sounds Like This. Tell us a little bit about that, and I hope everybody is getting fired up to go and get your books, because every one of these are just, you know, they're so well researched and the story just flows. And tell me about this book.
So Winning Sounds Like This, I spent a season in 20 years ago now, hard to believe, but with the women's basketball team at Gallaudet University. My brother and I actually coached a girls basketball team at a private school in New York for a while. And I, you know, grew up with basketball and loved it. But basketball was really only the vehicle to, they were a very good team that year. The year before, they had gone to the final 16 in the country. And I just got the idea about how fascinating it would be to sort of, you know, kind of peel back the cover and give people an insight into what it's like to be a deaf person in America. And Gallaudet in Northeast DC is the only 4-year school for the deaf and hard of hearing in the country. And so they had this terrific basketball team. And I really just sort of immersed myself in their culture and with their team. And I talked to their professors. I talked to their parents, the coaching staff. I went to all the games. I actually dressed up like an assistant coach and occasionally even diagrammed a play. But it was a fascinating experience, one of the richest experiences I've ever had. And to this day, Denny, I'll tell you, when they play the Star Spangled Banner at Gallaudet before a game, the students, of course, they don't hear it. It's in silence. So while hearing people are listening to the Star Spangled Banner, it's being signed. And to see the Star Spangled Banner performed in sign language, I can't even describe how powerful it is. And then at the end, I mean, the other thing I realized that, so they cannot hear clapping, but what they feel vibrations. So when the team goes on a 20-0 run and is, you know, just destroying the opposition, everyone is just pounding the bleachers with their feet, and that they feel. So the whole gym is shaking from the vibrations. I mean, it's not sound. It's much more a sensory experience. But one player after another was just incredibly gracious and kind in opening their lives up to me. Mm-hmm. And it was an experience I'll always treasure.
I coached high school basketball for a few years, and our team, we played a school for the deaf in one of the games in a tournament, and it was really interesting to see how they communicated. And you mentioned the vibrations, because one of the ways the coach would get their attention when their backs were turned on them at a free throw or whatever was to pound on the ground really hard. And I never saw a guy pound the ground so hard. Like, he could do it all the way across the court and they would quickly, you know, turn around. It was interesting. You know, I did some more deep intel, and I found out that team that you were the assistant coach for, that your brother was the head coach, went 41-5 over about 3 or 4 years. And that your brother felt like he put a lot of effort forward, yelling out, disciplining the team, and that you never yelled at him. And so he pegs those 5 losses on you.
Well, it was sort of the good cop, bad cop thing.
Okay.
You know, and he probably didn't tell you about how many technical fouls he got.
No.
Yeah, he was a powder keg. I mean, he never pulled a Bobby Knight and threw a chair, but he, but you know, he had to be talked in off the ledge now and again, and he knew a lot more basketball than I did. But I'd sort of cozy up to the players and just say, you know, he's just trying to make you be a better player. He's not the jerk you think he really is. So
Makes sense. I feel like I'm getting the Como brothers on my show one of these days.
Oh yeah. You have no idea what you're getting into here.
Yeah, I'm going after this one of these days. Hey, we got a video to preface our discussion about The Boys of Winter, which is, you know, the main book. I'm glad you took us through those other books though, because hopefully it piques some of our watchers' interest. So we got the this again is the book. Let's play a little video and then return to talk about this team.
Petrov controls, back to Parlamov, skating in on the left side, into the American end, 55 seconds, but Mikhailov has the puck, Mikhailov sweeping in, out in front, backhander goes wide, I think Craig might have got just a piece of it, Mikhailov, back out to Vilya Ledynov, 43 seconds remaining, Morrow, checked into the boards, it comes back to center ice, 38, 37 seconds left in the game, Petrov with it, the Americans on top, 4-3, long shot, Craig able to get a piece of it to sweep it away. 28 seconds. The crowd going insane. Karlamov shooting it into the American end again. Morrow is back there. Now Johnson, 19 seconds. Johnson over to Ramsey. Vilya Ledynov gets checked by Ramsey. McClanahan is there. The puck is still loose. 11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles?
It doesn't get old. I mean, I know we watch that Friday night as well. Sometimes we have different people that watch on different days, but it doesn't get old. And I even watched the whole game today. Just had it on in the living room. And when they scored, I still threw up my hands. And like, it doesn't get old.
It doesn't. It's, you know, I said, it's like automatic goosebumps every single time, 40 years later. And, yeah, and how great to hear that classic call by Al Michaels. And he was a young man then too. He was Al. I don't know that he was even 30 years old. And
I mean, you wrote a whole book on it, but it always gets tagged. And even I when I was talking about it, we talk about the miracle team. Do you think that's a good tag for that team? And is it okay? Like, you know, you wrote the Boys of Winter, but people will still say, oh, it's about the miracle team.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. Obviously, there was a very well-regarded Disney movie called Miracle. Yep. And but the players themselves sort of don't, I don't know, they don't necessarily embrace that term. I mean, I think in a sense, some of them feel like it it diminishes what they achieved. But, you know, we can, it's sort of a semantic point. When you look at the history of the Soviet hockey team against the Americans, the collective record in favor of the Soviets was 27-1-1 in world championship and Olympic play. The goal differential was 175-44. I mean, this was not a fair fight. This was, in the minds of many people, the greatest collection of hockey talent in the history of the sport. That same Soviet team, Denny, a year earlier, 1979, played the NHL All-Stars, and beat them 6-0.
Jeez.
And here's a collection of college kids, the youngest American Olympic team ever, and they really they had no shot, except you know what?
They just that 1 in 100 shot, and they pulled it off. It was their moment. You know, there's so much that backdrop that we you know, many of us know. 40 years ago, the height of the Cold War, America not feeling great about itself for several reasons and stuff. But at that age, I think I was like 14 or something. What really stuck in my craw was the 72 Olympic basketball game where the Soviets got 3 shots in order to overcome that after Doug Collins probably hit the most 2 pressured free throws in the history of basketball to put U.S. up. And then it just seemed like the fix was in. They gave them, they kept letting them try until they got that. And that still stuck with me until that 80 game. And there's all of those, there's all of that that just played into it. I thought that was so significant. Something I don't think everybody realizes this, Wayne, is that the Americans, had they lost that subsequent game to Finland, might not have even medaled.
That's
because that was exactly like a medal round, right? It was the 2 different pools, and so the top 2 go in, and the Americans were 2 out of like the blue division or something, and so even though they beat number 1 out of the red division, had they lost to Finland, Finland would have won the gold?
Yep.
Is that how that would have worked?
If, you know, it depends how the points you got. I think it would have been Finland. But if they had lost, there was a chance they could have gone home with no medals. So, you know, because it was such an iconic moment, that Friday night, February 22nd, 1980, when the U.S. beat the Soviets, people automatically assumed that won the gold medal. It did nothing of the sort. And, you know, that was still, you know, it was like the NCAA semifinal. They still had a game to play. And, you know, one of the things that I loved, I mean, Herb Brooks was not only just a towering hockey genius and an innovator and a man who I don't think any other coach in history could have pulled off what he did. But he was also just a spectacular motivator and knew exactly what note to play and when to play it. So in before the Soviet game on Friday night, you know, the guys are sitting. And as I mentioned the other night, Denny, the beauty of Herb Brooks Arena, which is, it's now named for Herb, appropriately so, on a little hilltop in Lake Placid, it looks very much the same as it did in 1980. It's got the same black grid on the ceiling. It's got the same red seats. You walk in there and you just feel this moment. You feel the history of it. And the locker rooms, locker room 5, where the U.S. team was, still looks the same. Wow. And Brooks is talking to his team in this little unadorned high school type locker room. And he tells the team, you were born to be a player. You were meant to be here. This moment is yours. And, you know, and I remember talking to Ken Morrow, who turned and like said to someone else, like Neil Broughton, the youngest guy in the team. And he said, "What's he talking about?" Neil Broughton said, "I have no idea." But they, but you know what? They charged out of that locker room behind Jim Craig, and they were like fired up beyond belief. And their marching orders that night were to just win every 35 second shift at a time. But so. So that was his motivational message Friday night.
Yeah.
And then Sunday, before they play Finland, now what does Herb Brooks say? I mean, how do you rally them again? And Herb Brooks goes in there. The guys are seated all around him in the same locker room 5. And he said, if you lose this game, you're going to take it to your bleeping grave. And you know what? That was perfect. The backup goalie, Steve Janizak, told me, like, in that moment, he envisioned himself like a 45-year-old guy sitting at a bar in Minnesota, like pounding his fist, saying, we could have won a gold medal. We could have won a gold. And you know what? That's exactly the message that he wanted to convey. So I
love that. I love that in the documentary, too, where each of the guys repeat, it's to your grave, you know, like every one of them goes, yep, they remember that line. Did you think I talked on Friday with you a little bit about the end of the first period, you know, when Mark Johnson got that goal right up with 1 second left or whatever. But, you know, that it was such a big game that Jim Craig had in goal. But do you think they were panicking when they pulled Tretiak, the Russian goalie, out of there? And I mean, everybody in the world was in awe of him. And so, I mean, was it some kind of punishment game? Was it just trying to mix it up? What was that all about?
No, it was complete and utter coaching meltdown. And so Vladislav Tretiak, for those who may not remember, he was the Soviet goalie widely regarded as maybe the greatest goalie ever. And a guy who was just, he's a very big presence in the net. And the guy was just, he was just royalty. He just, you know, almost impossible to beat. And he lets in this goal at 1959 when he skated out of his net and stood up a little bit and just, you know, and committed cardinal sin 101. You know, he relaxed. He didn't, and everyone on the ice did except Mark Johnson, the coach's kid, who went right to the horn. Got a rebound, stick handled around Tretiak, put it in at 1959. That tied the game at 2-2. The place went nuts. It gave the U.S. team hope. And then it created this panic. And Viktor Tikhonov, the Soviet coach, who's the most decorated coach in the history of international hockey, he's won more world championships and gold medals than anyone. And he yanks Tretiak because he was so furious at him. And one of the best interviews that I had, and most memorable parts of doing that book, is I figured, you know, there's an old saying in sports writing, Denny, that losing locker rooms are better than winning locker rooms, because you get, you know, you get heartache, you get angst, you get raw emotion, you get. And so I went to Moscow and I talked to Viktor Tikhonov, and I found someone to translate for me. And Viktor, what was interesting, he was still coaching. At the time, he was in his early 70s. I caught him at a rink, appropriately enough, and the guy looked exactly the same as he did in 1980. And I'm saying, it's the year 2000. How has this guy not changed? So, right. You know, as sort of a conversation breaker, I said through the interpreter, you know, Viktor, you know, thank you so much for giving me a few minutes of your time. I have to tell you, you look great. You haven't changed at all. And he smiled and he said, well, thank you. He said, women in Russia have a saying, if you want to preserve things for a long time, you put them in the freezer. I've spent my life in the freezer. Right. So who can argue? But Tikhonov told me that pulling Tretiak was the greatest single mistake of his coaching career.
Now, he did it, Wayne, though. Well, here's what was interesting, because I didn't kind of notice this until today when I was rewatching that. It happened, okay, so Mark Johnson scored. There was a confusion whether or not it was a goal. And the Russians had gone back to the locker room, but then there's got a 1 second, so they got to drop the puck again.
Yep.
And he sends out the backup.
Right.
And he doesn't even send out his whole line.
No, there were like two guys on the ice.
Yeah.
And he had Mishkin, the backup, was in the goal.
That was a little, I don't know, that just looked a little disorganized or submissive. Yeah, not submissive, but like disrespectful.
Well, he was, again, he was so furious that he was making the change. This was it. This was Mishkin's game now. And the American guy, and again, as I write in the book, this is like pinch hitting for Babe Ruth in the World Series.
Yeah.
And Arruzzioni and a couple of the other guys, when they saw what was going on, they said to Brooks, wait, Tretiak's gone. He's not in the net. And so And that fired them up even more. Like that, you know, that that TKO'd the great Vladislav Tretiak.
There's you know, so much more obviously in the book, and we got somebody else, our journalist at large, who's going to have a few questions for you in a second here, Wayne. So thanks for sticking around. But I just have to say, watching Yeruzioni's goal, that was the winning goal, and his dance up the sidelines is probably my favorite sporty moment celebration. Like, that is so much fun.
Yeah, it's it doesn't get any better. I mean, Mike has made a lifetime, a career out of fundraising and being a motivational speaker on the strength of that goal, and he's great at it. I'm not sure he'll ever make it as a dancer, but who cared? I mean, you'll never see a snapshot of a happier athlete in your whole life.
That was the best. Friday night, we had talked about how Casablanca had come up short on getting you some food in Sleepy Hollow, New York, even though they're Venice-based. They always hook up our guests. And so you asked that today that could make a move to your brother in Venice. So we want to show the very magnanimous moment from Friday night.
Well, fortunately, he's got a good meal and a margarita to keep him happy. So
I don't know why my boy Carlos cannot figure out putting that on a FedEx plane and getting it to my guests across the country, but we haven't got that part figured out yet.
Well, you know what? I do have another idea, though. There's a very special listener here, my brother in Marina Del Rey, who's the king of the Venice courts and can outshoot anybody. You know, so maybe the meal that you can't deliver to Sleepy Hollow, New York, can go to Hurricane Street in Marina Del Rey.
Oh, actually, absolutely. We can figure that out. Evidence right there. You called him a Marina Del Rey guy. No, mute.
So glad I changed shirts from Friday night.
Yes, yes. Oh, no doubt. Well, with that, we just if you hang around, it's appreciated. We want to give Casablanca their due, and then we'll be taking the cameras inside a Casablanca restaurant where our journalists at large will have a couple questions for you.
And Denny, I just want to tell you, I hear that Casablanca came up really big, that their chicken fajitas are the bomb. So, I mean, I think everyone should be beating it over there right now, including Sandy Caligiuri and Saranac Lake. It's, you know, there are plenty of seats to be had on the airplanes right now. So I think Sandy needs to get there. It can get there for, you know, maybe happy hour on Friday.
They deliver everywhere. And so, and those margaritas are fantastic. So, well, you'll see here, this is my buddy, Ray, who was a speedster in his own right when we were growing up. Might've done 4.5 40.
Wow.
Yeah.
You may. Well, remind me never to race him.
Okay. Yes. Don't you be okay. I could even beat him today. this is my buddy, Ray, Box Cobbler Entertainment. One of his best commercials. It's up for a Clio, I think.
Vámonos a Casablanca, vámonos a Casablanca, la comida para la familia. Vámonos a Casablanca, vámonos a Casablanca.
Man, it's high level. It's high level, Wayne. All right, so we're gonna take the cameras inside at Casablanca restaurant in Venice, where our journalist, critic, book critic at large. Yeah? There she is. Hi, uh-oh. Alejandra. She's got her up. Hold on. Christine's going to put your microphone up. Got it? Okay, go ahead.
Good evening.
Hi. Thanks for being here. You're the Sports Stories with Denny Lennon, book critic at large. That's what your title is. Do you like that title? Yeah, it's all right. Okay. If you think of something better, you usually do. You let me know. And say hello to our guest today, Wayne Coffey.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Wayne Coffey.
Ms. Alexandria Harrow.
Yep.
And I have to ask you, what's your favorite restaurant? You better answer this right now.
Probably. Either Casablanca or Lari's.
Excellent. Now, wait a minute. Is that apple up there? Because you're going to like, is that like an apple polishing technique to curry favor with your guest?
Probably. My mom just said, put an apple in there or add some spice on it.
I love it.
Okay, good luck, Wayne. Take it away, Alexandra.
Okay, Danny. I'll do my best.
Good evening, Mr. Wayne Coffey. My name is Alexandria Haro. And before I start, I would just like to say your book was fantastic.
Oh my gosh, thank
to
you
read,
so much. Thank you for reading it. I love people who read books.
All those fans out there should read his book. It is really good.
Do you accept cash payments, Alexandria? All right. We may have to talk after the show because you're being so nice and supporting my writing career. I really appreciate it. I'm kidding, but I appreciate your kind words.
Thank you. Now, you wrote a book, The Boys of Winter, and it's basically about Coach Up encouraging a team to be more like a team and basically doing more than they think they can, if I am correct. Now I have a few questions
Please.
For you, actually, now. And if you don't feel comfortable answering the questions, just blink,
blink twice,
like this. So I can move
okay,
right
do I need to have my lawyer
question.
Nearby, or are we okay? Okay.
No, we're okay. My first question is, you never got to interview Coach Herb regarding your book. What one question would you ask?
Well, that is a great, great question. Actually, I was going to, I've interviewed Herb Brooks a number of times, but not for this book. And this is actually very sad, Alexander. It's terribly sad. The day I was scheduled to interview him, it was August 3rd, I want to say 2003 was the day he died in a car accident. I was supposed to interview him that night, and he died that afternoon in a car. And it's chilling to even think about that. But I think what I would ask Herb is, you know, everybody in the world thought that your team had no chance in this game. And just 10 days before that game in Lake Placid, that famous game, the same teams met in Madison Square Garden and the Russians destroyed the Americans 10-3. So what I ask Herb is, in your heart of hearts, what did you really think was going to happen that night in Lake Placid? Did you think that your guys legitimately had a chance?
That's a really good question to ask him. My second question is, what is your favorite word? I like to know because it took me a long time to read your book because I had to use the dictionary to look up the words.
So my favorite word... you know, I'm not even sure what I have a lot of favorite words. I love words. In fact, there's something I get in my inbox and my email every day. Merriam-Webster has like, they'll send you a word of the day and it just pops up every day. And I love it. I love language. I love learning new words. And one that comes to me right now is, a word called epiphany. Epiphany. You know what epiphany means? So epiphany is like, I want to say a revelation, like a surprising, like a shocking, surprising. Well, like if you went out, you walked out from where you are right now and walked in the street and you saw the most amazing rainbow or something like you'd never seen before, or you know, a school of 100 dolphins in the Pacific Ocean. It would be an epiphany.
I'm going to tell all my friends that because we're doing online learning, and I like to share them every word I knew because I want them to be as smart as they can be.
Yeah, I think you might score some points with epiphany, but it's a really good word. You don't want to roll it out every day, but it's good to have in your back pocket.
All right.
This is one of the best interviews I've ever had, by the way.
My third question is, you have a daughter that is also a fantastic writer. When she was my age, I am currently 9 years old, and when she was writing an English paragraph, did you correct her work with a red pen and make her do it again and again like Coach Herb did?
You know, I did not. I would maybe try to be helpful, make some suggestions, but she was really talented. And you know what? What's really interesting, Alexandra? Her name is Alexandra. Though she goes by Alex. She loves to be called Alex. And so her byline, she writes for a terrific sports website called The Athletic. And she actually has a big story coming up that I'm not allowed to divulge the contents of because it's a top level secret. So maybe when you see it, I think for a lot of people who read it, it'll come as something of an epiphany to them actually. Mm-hmm. But Alex, my daughter, who I refuse to call by the name she prefers, was really gifted from a young age. So I would just try to encourage her to write. And you know, writing is the, no matter how long you do it, if you work hard at it, you keep getting better. It's hard. You know, I teach writing classes sometimes, and I tell people if you think, whether you're 9 years old or 49 or 89, like my brother in Venice, if you think that writing is hard, you're right, because it is. It's hard work. And to this day, if I see a blank screen in front of me, a blank computer screen with no words on it, like I think, oh my gosh, what am I going to write? I have no idea. Maybe I'm going to run out of words. But you just sort of sit with it, and that's sort of what I learned to do. And I just try to encourage my daughter to do her best, you know, and to pursue her passion. And we did that with all our kids. And now she's writing. She's so much better than I was at her age. It's not even close.
It's funny because when I play softball and all these sports, all my coaches call me Alex, and they every time on my jersey is just Alex. That's not my full name.
Do you like being Alex?
Sometimes. Most of my times they call me Alexandra, but I always have to correct them as Alexandria, so they always call me Alex. So I'm fine with it.
That's good to be.
My dad hates it.
He hates what? Alex?
He hates when people call me Alex.
Yeah, see, I'm the same way. It must be a father thing because you have a beautiful name. And I just like Alexandra. Now, here's another fancy word for you, Alexandra. You know the word etymology. That's
nope.
That's the study of words. And so the etymological roots of Alexandria or Alexandra, it means helper of mankind. How can you do better than that? Your name means that you help people.
Wow.
So, and if I ever get to meet you, I'm going to make sure that just because I want to stay on your father's good side in case he wants to run some fajitas by me, I'm going to call you Alexandria.
I sometimes go with the A train because I've seen her play ball. And she, she doesn't mess around.
Uh-huh.
Alexandria, do you have another question? Because I have to do the rapid fire questions with them. So you got one more?
Yep.
You do? Take it away, A-Town.
Would you rather be at the 1969 World Series game with the Miracle Mets or be at the Miracle on Ice game?
Well, I was in real life at once, so I would have to say I'd love to be at the Miracle on Ice game and hear feel that arena, like, you know, throbbing with excitement on a snowy night in Lake Placid. And it's the greatest sports moment of the 20th century. So, and it was a night for dreamers because the impossible happened that night. So, and it'll never happen again. It will never, ever happen again. So that's pretty darn magical.
Well, thank you for letting me interview you. It was truly an honor. And when you come down Venice at Casablanca Restaurant, just give me a call. It's my seat. And we can talk about hockey and soccer. Maybe you can correct some of my English assignments.
Yeah.
And we can have fun.
You know what, Alexandra? I think you're doing great by yourself. And so can I talk to you directly, or should I have my people talk to your people?
She runs
whatever you like.
She runs the joint, so you could just call her up. Carlos reports to her.
I see. Well, I hope is Carlos having a good day? Is he following your orders today, Alexandra?
Mostly.
Yeah. Well, you know what? You just make sure you tell him that if he doesn't listen to you every word, he's going to have to deal with Denny Lennon.
That's right. That's his coach.
And that is no, that's no, yeah, he's a coach. He's a lifetime sportsman.
Right.
He knows a high-level volleyball player, so you don't want to be messing with Denny.
All right. Big A. You did well.
Thank you, Alexandria.
You killed it
today.
Thank
you. Bye.
Hi.
That a girl. She's all right, that one. She's okay, that one.
She's the best.
Yeah, that's okay. she cracks me up. All right, here we go. Rapid-fire questions. You prepared for this?
I'm going to try. I think I sort of peaked with Alexandria, but let's give it a go.
Here we go. what's your first pet's name when you're a kid?
Frisky.
What kind of pet?
Cat. I threw her down the stairs once and she never forgave me, but.
Your favorite sports team as a kid?
Mets.
Your nickname growing up?
Junior, as in longtime NFL fullback, Junior Coffey.
Nice. All right. Favorite board game playing when you're a kid?
Oh, Monopoly. No brainer.
I like Strat-O-Matic myself. Favorite main dish? Now.
Now?
Yep.
Eggplant parm.
Favorite dessert now?
Cheesecake.
Favorite movie all time?
Field of Dreams.
Favorite musical group all time?
Beatles.
Favorite author or book outside of your own family?
That is a tough one. We'll go with Ernest Hemingway.
All right. Favorite professional athlete of all time?
Mickey Mantle.
Do you have a quote, a go-to quote, your favorite?
Yeah, I would say this is a quote. It's not a sports quote, but there was a famous scholar and statesman. I don't know if he was Secretary of State once, but George F. Kennan, his quote, it might even be in The Boys of Winter. But George F. Kennan once said, "Heroism is endurance for one moment more."
Whoa. Okay. What is your go-to TikTok dance move? Oh, wait. Sorry. That's for my teenage kid. Sorry. I left that over there.
Yeah. You know what? You're going to be really disappointed in my go-to TikTok dance move. Any of my dance moves, you'll be disappointed with.
If you're going to pick a movie between Miracle and Slapshot, what are you going with?
Miracle.
Oh, love Slapshot, though. That was solid.
Do I get thrown off the show if I've never seen Slapshot?
No, oh, really? Well, if
yeah, Friday, you know what? Can I tell you something, Denny? Don't tell anybody this because this is.
Yes.
I've never seen Gone with the Wind.
Ooh, wow. All
right. I know. What kind of dysfunctional American.
Have you seen the movie Casablanca?
I have. Love that.
You're okay with the show then. All right.
Here's looking at you, Denny.
That's right. There's what I like to call the West Side of Los Angeles Mexican Food Syndicate. There's four restaurants that this family controls, and you get to pick one for a favorite dinner. These restaurants include La Cabana, Gilbert's El Indio, Paco's Tacos, or Casablanca.
Do I have to pick one, or?
To pick one.
I'm going with Casablanca.
I figured that one was coming. They're doing the most.
You know, and you know why? Because I want to stay on Alexandria's good side. So
that makes sense. That does make sense. You're very nice to stay on for so long. Appreciate it.
I'm happy to do it. It was great being on with you. And you know what? I had a great time, and I'm so impressed with Alexandria Harrow. I'm going to remember that name. Mm-hmm. And I think she may want to, she talked about correcting her English assignments. I think I may need to send her manuscripts for her to work on.
Right. Punch them up a little.
Yeah. And we'll definitely punch them up.
Hey, man, you're the best. Thank you, Wayne, for being on. And you're going to be my go-to guy. Whenever your book's coming out, I hope you'll come back on.
All right, Denny. Well, listen, it was a pleasure, and it'd be a pleasure to be back on, and we'll keep those deliveries going to Venice.
Yes, there you go. We will. All right.
All right. All the best. Have a good night.
Same, buddy. All right. All right. That didn't suck. I love going over some of those events from the past and sports, and just kind of remembering their place. Because it brings us all something, you know, right? Whether you didn't know about them or you do, and you get inspired by great athletes, great teams, and that kind of thing. And then a great author can do that for you. All right. That was a great show. Remember, tomorrow is BBC number 4. Yep. Mike Boley producing, the 2-time BBC champ, Mike Boley. Wednesday, Paul George as a high school basketball player, iconic footage. I mean, nobody has this footage but us. And so we're fortunate that we have that, and we have the original broadcast team that's going to bring that to you, and that's Wednesday. Remember, this is always at 5:00. Thursday, we drop our video podcast with Wayne Boley, and Friday, the happy hour show of record, St. John Smith, Jim Mangus. That's going to be a blast. All right, we did it. We out.
Sports Stories with Denny Lennon is supported by the AAU. Find a local event and join at aausports.org. And remember, you can catch your favorite amateur sports live stream, replays, and highlights at ballertv.com. Sports Stories, along with East Bay, supports the Heroes Movement, a nonprofit that bridges the gap from mental or physical therapy to getting strong again through strength and conditioning workouts. This free service is available for any veteran of the United States Armed Forces. Visit heroesmovementusa.org for more information. Sports Stories, along with thousands of people across the country, also supports the My Stuff Bags Foundation, a nonprofit that provides traumatized children with new belongings and new hope. Learn more at mystuffbags.org. Sports Stories with Denny Lennon is a production of Sports Stories, Inc., and is available on Apple Podcasts and YouTube, or wherever you listen and watch. Don't forget to subscribe, rate, and give us a review. It really helps spread the word. You can find all our social media links, archives, and other info on our website at sportsstoriespodcast.com. Special thanks to the John R. Wooden Course and Wooden's Wisdom. Original music for Sports Stories is courtesy of Lennon Music Productions. Original images by Sienna Lennon Photography. Sports Stories is produced by Christine Jimbo and Marley Rice. Sports Stories is edited by Bob McCall. Additional staff include Ray Castro, Teresa Dolan, Jake Downey, Carlos Haro, and Buck Magic Lennon.
I've been running down the road trying to loosen my load. Got Sports Stories on my mind. Looking for the look, it might be on Facebook. It's not hard to find. Sports Stories with Denny. Come and watch it with me and take it easy. Come and watch on YouTube. It starts at 5:00. If there's any chance to talk, it's with Sports Stories. See you next week. Whoa!
Kick it out, Book!
Yeah, kick it out! Kick it out! Yeah, buddy! Way to kick it out! Good job!